Jesus loves even me. I am so glad that my Father in heaven tells of his love in the book he has given. Wonderful things in the Bible I see. This is the dearest that Jesus loves me.
Tonight, turn with me, please, to the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah, and we're going to look together at chapter number 8 here in just a moment. Nehemiah, chapter number 8, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, then Ezra, then Nehemiah. If you hit Revelation, you went too far. Take a left, and you'll get there eventually. Nehemiah, chapter number 8, and we'll look together at several verses here in just a moment. While you're turning, let me just say again, hey, glad that you're here tonight. Thanks for coming out on Sunday night, and it's a privilege for us to be able to be here. Everybody's in the service tonight, but I think everybody's pretty much met all the kiddos and everything now. So we enjoy talking to people. So if after the service we haven't had a chance to chat, that's something we enjoy doing. Before the service, my brain is usually fairly focused, so it's harder for me to have any length or depth of conversation. It's usually, hi, my name is, what's your name, what do you do for a living, great, and that's about the end of it. But after the service, my brain isn't nearly as engaged as it is during the first part of it. So who knows what I'll say at the end of the service. There's really no telling. But it'll be fun, whatever it is. All right, Nehemiah chapter number 8, and we're going to begin reading in verse number 1. We're kind of picking up in the middle of a story of the life of Nehemiah and how God used this man, Nehemiah. This is a great passage that talks about a time in Israel's history when they needed desperately to be revived. That is, where they needed to come back to God. And in this instance, in this case that we're about to read in just a moment, they did come back to God. And it's a very special time. Nehemiah chapter number 8. And because of the length of verses that I'm going to read, I'm going to have you stay seated. But please do keep your brain engaged in what is going on. All right? Nehemiah 8 verse 1. The Bible says, "And all the people gathered themselves together as one man in the street that was before the water gate. And they spake unto Ezra, who was the scribe, to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. And Ezra, the priest, brought the law before the congregation, both of men and women, and all that could hear with understanding," that is, kiddos that were old enough to understand, "upon the first day of the seventh month. And he read therein before the street that was before the water gate, from the morning until the midday, before the men and the women and those that could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive unto the book of the law. And Ezra the scribe stood upon a pulpit of wood," think platform, "which they had made for the purpose. And beside him stood a group of men whose names I would massacre if I read them." So I'm going to skip down to verse number 5. "And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people," for he was above all the people. "And when he opened it, all the people stood up." And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, with lifting up their hands. And they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Also, Jeshua and Bani and Sherebiah, Jamin, Acab, Shabbatai, Hadijah, Messiah, Kalida, Azariah, Jozabad, Hanan, Peleah, and the Levites caused the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place. So they read in the book and the law of God distinctly and gave the sense and caused them to understand the reading. And Nehemiah, which is the Tirshatha, that is, he's the governor, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto the people, This day is holy unto the Lord your God. Mourn not nor weep, for all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Father, I pray that tonight you'd help us to have the reaction that is right to our hearing your word. I don't know what you're doing in the hearts and minds and lives of each person that's here. But for some, it may mean that they need to weep when they hear your word. And for others, it may be a rejoicing or perhaps a commitment that needs to be made. But Father, please help us in this evening to have your presence in the service in such a way so that we're fully convinced of what your word has to say and that we would leave determined by your grace to fulfill what it is you've placed in our hearts and the things that need to be changed, that we'd be ready to change them. And the areas that we need encouragement, that we receive that. And perhaps if there are some here who need encouragement on staying the course and walking with you, or some that are cold towards you and their relationship with you needs to heat up, I pray, dear Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you would do the work in each person individually and in this church corporately that needs to be done. And I ask this, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I don't know if you've ever been in services much that are referred to as revival services like these are. More accurately, we could say that these are services that we set aside in order to seek God regarding revival. That is, our calling them revival services doesn't mean that all of us will be revived, only that in this time we're gathering together for the purpose of seeking God and desiring God to revive our hearts. In Nehemiah chapter number 8, we have a service that takes place that is exactly like the services that I would love to see every time that I preach. There's not a service that I'm privileged to preach where I don't first take some time and ask God to do something special, to work in people's hearts in the service. I almost always do in my prayer after I've read the scripture and pray for us corporately, where I ask God to do what only He can do in convincing and working. Now the reason for that is because I'm convinced, I know, based upon the scriptures, that God's presence changes everything. For many of us, we're going through things in our lives where we desperately need the touch of God. We're surrounded on a daily basis, every day, regularly. We are bombarded by the cares and concerns of this world, and we're surrounded by things that would pull our hearts, our own flesh, would pull us away from following after God. The hymn writer wrote it this way, "Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it." Anybody else know that to be true in their own life and experience? My tendency is always to walk away from God, and I need the help of God to be brought back. And when we're in God's presence, or we know God's presence, and we're walking with the Lord the way God would have us to, man, all that changes. Everything is the way it's supposed to be. We live in fullness of joy, and everything is where it's supposed to be. So when I read in Nehemiah chapter 8 about this service that took place, and I read about the reviving that happened in the lives of all the Israelites that gathered together under the sound of the reading and explaining of the law of God, I think to myself, that is exactly the kind of services I want to see. That's exactly the kind of service I'd like to have tonight, where God's presence moved in and stirred among us in such a way so that those who are cold towards the things of the Lord, or those who are not walking with God the way that they ought to, or perhaps sin has crept in and we've allowed it and we've justified it and we've excused it, where we would see it for what it is and we'd get back in right relationship with God. For others, perhaps it's an area of growth that needs to take place in order for us to be where we ought to be and doing what we ought to do. And Nehemiah chapter 8 records for us that kind of service. So when I see something like that, my first reaction is, which I'm sure would be yours as well, is, okay, if that's what we desire, if that's what we need. By the way, time out. Now forgive me for asking a question for which I'm asking you to agree with me already, because it's all right for you to disagree with people. Do we, as a church, do we need to see God work in and through us? Yes or no? I mean, is a service like this, is a reviving service something that you and I corporately and personally need? Yes or no?
Yes, it is.
Well, sure it is. Sure it is. Brittany and I have the privilege of traveling all over the United States and preaching in different churches almost every week. And almost every week, though we are in good churches like this, where the Bible is preached and people love God and love each other, without exception, in every church we're privileged to preach in, there is always a need, at least in the hearts of many of the people that come to God, to get right with the Lord, to walk with God, to have a heart that is fully surrendered to Him and is on fire for God and has God's power in their lives or in their families and in their service towards Him. So again, when I read this in Nehemiah chapter 8, immediately my mind is drawn to, okay, if they had this kind of service, what is it that took place in order for this to happen? Because this is what we need. So what is it that happened? What goes into it? Is it just a matter of God can send this kind of service when He wants to without any involvement on our part? It's just if God decides to, boom, He shows up and everything changes. Or is it that God expects from us some things, and then in response, God moves in and works in our hearts? Well, if the Bible is true, and it is, all throughout Scripture, God says, if you, then I. If you will, then I will. And I believe that's certainly the case when it comes here to Nehemiah chapter 8. So what is it that took place in order for this service to take place? Three things in particular, just briefly as we walk through this. The first thing that happened, the first thing that's involved in this service, how this revival service took place, that will have to be in the services this week that we have together tonight and throughout this week and in this church if Nehemiah 8 services are going to take place. The first thing is that the Word of God has to be preached. Look down at Nehemiah 8. That really is what we just read. You can look down at verse number 8, where it's kind of a summary verse of everything else that we read. Verse 8. I'm gonna start reading, and I'm going to let you fill in the blanks of a few words, all right? The Bible says, so they read in the
book,
in the law of God distinctly, and gave the
sense,
and caused them to
understand
the reading. Okay, so what's mentioned here is this. Here's the picture. Ezra and Nehemiah and a group of men, Levites, are up on, the Bible says a pulpit, but it means literally a platform. So don't think, it's not like they were standing on the pulpit. It's not that they were Southern and that's what they did. It was just that they built a platform and they're standing up on the top of this platform and they read, the Bible says, and they read in the book of the law distinctly, and then they gave the sense. That is, they read what the Bible said, they read what God had to say, and then they said, let me explain that to you. Okay, that is the purest definition of what preaching is and preaching the Bible. Okay, now listen to me. Please get this. And get everything, think. Don't just let this go over your head like, yeah, Brother Tim, we know this already. That is what must take place. That is what must be present if this church, if the churches of this nation, if this nation is going to see revival, then it must base on the preaching of God's Word. You can get a crowd together in the name of religion, even in the name of Christianity, even in the name of Christ, by doing other things. But it is not other things that will cause revival. It is not other things that can change the hearts of people. God has chosen to use the foolishness of preaching to convince people of the truth of God's Word. And preaching must be present. This is not an opportunity for me to bash on anybody else. I thank God for any place that preaches God's word and tells people how they can be saved through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But listen to me. Any ministry, any so-called church that's emphasis is anything besides the preaching of the word of God may be able to draw a big crowd and may be able to stir up the emotions of people and may even have a lot of activities that are good and fine activities and some that are outreach kind of activities. They can do all of that, listen to me, but revival cannot come outside of the preaching of God's word being preeminent, of it being put out there so people can understand what the Bible has to say. And by the way, it's preaching God's word. It's just simply, let me read it, let me tell you what it means, because God's word is what changes lives. Now, I tell you that for a couple reasons. Number one, because I need to put myself on record. That is, you need to know that myself as a preacher, a pastor as a preacher, our responsibility primarily when we stand in this pulpit is to just give you what the Bible says, not to come up with things that we think or that we hope for or make up stuff. It is primarily for us to explain to you what the Bible says for your benefit, for your good, so you can draw closer to the Lord. The second reason I mention this is because there is a big pull, especially for people in my generation and younger, to get pulled from ministries that are primarily Bible preaching ministries and get sucked into ministries or churches whose emphasis is the music, or whose emphasis is how big everything looks, or how bright the lights can be, or how cool or hip it is. We don't even use that word anymore, but I'm using it, you understand. how with it everything is. And so since it's all this, then this must be what's happening. This must be what's real. This must be what's in and new. I mean, after all, it reaches out to people and connects with people so that people feel comfortable in coming. As long as people feel comfortable in coming, then that's what we're after. Okay, listen. Don't fall into the trap. Don't fall into the thinking that allows for that. If the ministry is based on anything besides the simple explanation of what the Bible has to say, then you can have a crowd, you can have numbers, you can have excitement, you can have energy, but you cannot have revival. And revival is what we need. I don't need to be stirred up to make it through a week. I need God's presence to make it through a week. I don't need an emotional high to serve God. I need to meet with the one on high in order to serve God. And Nehemiah 8 is there. The service takes place because of the preaching of God's word. Determine in your heart, friends, determine in your heart that wherever in the future God may take you, whatever He has for you, that you are always going to be part of a Bible preaching church, a Bible preaching ministry where God's word being preached, explained, is what is primary. So if Nehemiah 8 services are going to take place, number one, the Bible must be preached. Number two, if Nehemiah 8 services are going to take place, the only way you can get to Nehemiah chapter 8 is if you go through Nehemiah chapter 1. Because Nehemiah chapter 1 comes before Nehemiah chapter 8. So turn back with me real quickly, would you please? If you want to get to Nehemiah 8 services, where God's word obviously does the work, so much so that the people, when they hear the word of God, they respond through weeping, so that the people have to say, stop weeping. The leaders say, stop weeping. They responded to God's word in such a way that was significant. Well, that happened because Nehemiah chapter 1 happened several years before. Nehemiah chapter 1, this is the beginning of what we know about Nehemiah. The Bible says, the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah, and it came to pass in the month Chislu, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan the palace, this is Nehemiah speaking, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said unto me, well, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province, that is back in Jerusalem, are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down. The gates thereof are burned with fire. And it came to pass, when I heard these words, that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven and said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God that keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Let thine ear be now attentive and thine eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now day and night for the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against thee, both I and my father's house have sinned. And the rest of the chapter is a prayer that Nehemiah makes before God. Okay, let me tell you basically what happens. Nehemiah is working as a slave, as a servant, to a king by the name of Artaxerxes. And he's in Shushan the palace. And this is Artaxerxes' winter palace. And his job is the food tester. He's the wine bearer. So he would eat the food before the king ate it, basically make sure it's not poison. Also was a close counselor to the king. So if the king, a foreign king, his servant was Nehemiah, and they would have had a pretty close relationship. After all, you would want to have a good relationship with a guy who tests your food for poison. You want to make sure he's telling you the truth and that everything is good between you two. Okay, so here's Nehemiah, and he hears from his brethren back in Jerusalem that the gates of the city of Jerusalem are burned with fire, the walls are pushed down, and the people are in great affliction. Okay, now this told Nehemiah something. Let me just kind of get you on page historically, and I'll make this brief, but please do your best to pay attention with what I'm saying, okay? God had told the people of Israel, if you obey me and follow me, I will see to it that your enemies are always kept at bay. They will not be able to come in. I will protect you. I will provide for you. Your fields will always bear fruit. You will always be able to have children. Everything will go the way it's supposed to go. God says, if you will just make sure you follow me, everything will be good. So that when Nehemiah heard from these brethren of his that the gates were burned fire and the walls were pushed down, Nehemiah knew things were not going well back in Jerusalem. The people of God were not serving God. They were not following. The Israelites weren't doing right because God wasn't protecting them. And so he hears about this, and immediately he's brought into the realization that things are not as they should be. Okay, now think. Are things as they should be today? That is, are you and I living in great power like God promised we would? Are we living victorious over sin in churches? Are believers stronger today in their marriages? Are things going well in reaching out and seeing lost people saved? Are we living the life that God intended us to live, victorious and in service? And are we hot and on fire when it comes to our relationship with Christ? Is everything good in the way that it should be? Or could it be described better than, man, we need a little bit of help? Okay, then the question becomes, if we need help, if we are in trouble and the world around us and our nation is in trouble and there are people that need to be saved and we're not seeing it happen, then that ought to cause us, that's got to bring us to some kind of contemplation of either, well, we just hang on until God comes and that's the way it's going to be, or else we say, what is it that is the problem? Is there something that is stopping? Is there something that we can do to see God's power on our lives, to have a Nehemiah 8 service, so that we can reach out and see people saved, where when people come in, the Spirit of God moves and lost people are saved, and those who are away from the Lord are drawn close to the Lord. So what is it that needs to happen? And Nehemiah heard from his brethren that the walls were pushed down and the gates were burned with fire, and he knew that they weren't following God, and his immediate response was, listen to this, and catch the significance of this. The first response of Nehemiah was to drop to his knees and say, God, we need you. See, here's the deal. Way too often, my first response is, okay, what activity can I do to make all the things happen that need to happen? Where do I need to throw money at? Maybe we need more lights. Maybe there's something that I can, an atmosphere that I can create. And our first thought, when there's a need for the power and working of God, is, how can I organize? How can I spend? What can I do to make this happen? And Nehemiah 8, now listen to this, Nehemiah 8 took place not because of the amount of money that he put into it. Nehemiah 8 took place because in Nehemiah chapter 1, when Nehemiah thought about, considered, and realized the situation and the great need, he fell on his knees, and the Bible said that he prayed and he fasted. Okay, now friends, listen to me. Now please hear me. We need Nehemiah 8 services. We need services like in Nehemiah 8 when the Bible is given that people respond and those who are away from God come back to God and sin is dealt with and the lost are saved. We need Nehemiah 8 services. But Nehemiah 8 services aren't going to come unless there's a time in Nehemiah chapter 1 where God's people get on their knees and say, God, you're right. Man, we've been hooked up to, we've been married to the world. We fall in love with things that don't matter. God, we have sin in our lives. We have not been right before you. God, we have sinned and we need your help. And the Bible says that he mourned and he fasted and he prayed for certain days. Certain days means, translates, the time between Nehemiah chapter 1 and Nehemiah chapter 8 was about 7 months. 1 month was, or a month and a half was rebuilding the wall, but for 6 months, Nehemiah came before God. Okay, now listen to me. Look, I know, because I'm human too, I would much rather do something than to spend time just praying about it. It is easier for me. Okay, all right. Gentlemen, if you have the choice of waiting in traffic for a half an hour to get to a destination because there's an accident or something, or driving an extra half an hour around the traffic, even if you get to the destination at the same time, how many of you would rather drive around just so you can be moving and get, even if you're going to get to the destination at the same time? How many of you would rather drive an extra half an hour out of the way just to be moving instead of waiting in traffic? Okay, totally. I would so much rather, because there's always a chance that I can get there faster. At least I'm moving. I'm not depending on the knucklehead in front of me who's not moving when he could. He's letting people in. They cheated and got in line way up higher. So you don't let those kind of people in, you know, and you can't control that. So at least I can be moving and going around. Okay, I would much rather do something than to wait. All right. But if Nehemiah 8 services are going to take place, and I mean this, and so does God, the only way legitimately it's going to happen is when God's people get on their knees before God and they say to him, we need you. God, we're in trouble. God, I'm not seeing people saved, and I don't have your power. I'm losing the victory here, God. My relationship to you is cold, and the hearts of the people around us are cold, and this nation, the city, Fort Lauderdale needs you, God. We need to see your power. We need to see your work, God, please. And then God says, well, I'd like to, but there's some stuff. Well, God, you're right. I'm wrong. I'm sorry. If you say that's wrong, it's done. It's out. But God, we need you. And we just continuously come and come. And I will tell you unashamedly tonight, I ask God to touch the hearts of some in this church who will give themselves to some seasons of Nehemiah chapter 1 so that Nehemiah 8 can take place. This is not just preacher talk. This is not just something that's supposed to be said because it's a service. Nehemiah chapter 1 is an absolute necessity if Nehemiah 8 is going to take place. We need Nehemiah 8. But in order to get there, you got to go to Nehemiah 1. So, the Bible must be preached. Secondly, if Nehemiah 8 is going to take place, there's got to be some significant time, perhaps months. It could be a couple of years, just given to asking God, to do something special. Then the third thing, oh, by the way, and this is neat. Nehemiah prays for a while. The Bible says that after he's prayed for 6 months, he comes before the king, and the Bible says his presence is down, his visage is down. That is, he looks sad. And he comes to the king, and Nehemiah said, I never looked that way to the king. Well, the king got nervous, and it says to Nehemiah, Nehemiah, what's wrong? Well, I would be nervous too. If I had a food taster who is supposed to eat the poison for me, and he comes before me sad, I would be a little nervous. And so he says to Nehemiah, Nehemiah, what's the problem? And the Bible says, Nehemiah said, well, the people back in my homeland in Jerusalem, the gates are burned with fire, the walls are pushed down, the people are in reproach. I don't know what to do. And the king, the foreign king, the master over the servant, says to the servant, what do you want? The Bible says that Nehemiah prayed to the Lord, and he said to the king, in essence, I need time off, I need safe passage, I need to get a hold of some wood in order to rebuild the gates. I want to go back and rebuild these walls. And the king, the foreign king, says, Nehemiah, you got it, man. Go ahead. Okay, let me tell you what that is. That's a miracle.
That is
God opening up a door. God saying yes to the prayers of Nehemiah and opening up the opportunity for something special to happen. Listen. We live in the United States of America where we can no longer pray in public schools and you can't preach in public schools anymore. But there is a God in heaven who can open up doors if people ask. The king's heart is still in the hand of the Lord. And his rivers of water, he can still move it whithersoever he wants to. This is God we're talking about. And sometimes we beat our heads against the wall wondering, why are there no opportunities? Where are the opportunities to reach out and see people? And when we'll spend time before God, begging God to do what only he can do, then God will open up a door that will give us the opportunity to reach out and see Nehemiah 8 services take place. I'm telling you, God can open up doors today just like he did for Nehemiah. So Nehemiah gets on his donkey and he rides to Jerusalem. When he gets to Jerusalem, the Bible says that he rides around the city the first night. He looks at everything that needs to be done. The next day, he meets with all of the leaders of Israel. And he says, okay, guys, let me tell you about what God has done for me. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to rebuild this wall. And then Nehemiah chapter 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 all take place before Nehemiah 8 can happen. So Nehemiah 8 services can happen, but you got to go through Nehemiah chapter 1, and then you got to go through Nehemiah chapter 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And Nehemiah chapters 2 through 7 can all be summed up in one four-letter word that begins with W and ends with K. Can anybody tell me what the word is?
Work.
What it is. And it is work, man, let me tell you. These guys get out. And they are taking rocks, and they're building the wall, and they're taking mortar, and they're laying it down, and they do some hard labor work, just doing the stuff that needs to happen in order for this wall to be built. Why build the wall? Why build the wall? Because there needs to be a Nehemiah 8 service, because people need to get right with God. So we got to have this protection. We got to build this wall. So they get out and they do the work. And you say, Brother Tim, I know what you mean. We need a labor and prayer. No. We do need a labor and prayer. That's Nehemiah 1. But we need a labor and labor. Hey, let me encourage you. Look. Don't be on the sideline of when God opens up a door to be able to reach out. Don't be on the sideline and not involved and invested in the ministry opportunity that God has given to you. We say, I'm busy. I know, bless your heart. I know everybody's busy and working hard and everything. But the opportunity to reach out and win people is what eternity is all about. And you can invest in a lot of now, or you can invest in a lot of later. And a lot of later is what's pretty important, don't you think? Okay, so here we have... We have all these people, and they were doing the work. It was a work that had some oppression. That is, there were people that didn't want the work to happen. There were people without. There's two guys named Sanballat and Tobiah. Just the very names make it sound like there should be like dreaded organ music in the background. You know, Sanballat and Tobiah. Wah, wah, wah. And Sanballat and Tobiah, they stood without, and they mocked, they made fun of, they threatened. They said, if a fox walks on that wall, it's going to fall down. And Nehemiah, listen to this, I love this. So instructive to me. Nehemiah says to God, God, you see these guys? Can you take care of them? I'm working on this wall you told me to do. You opened up this opportunity. Can you please take care of these guys on my behalf? They're causing problems. And God does take care of them. And Nehemiah just keeps on working on the wall. He just keeps on building the wall and he gets all the people. Hey, there were some people inside. There were some noblemen, some rich guys that said, we're not going to work. And there were some noblemen who would not put their necks to the work. You know, sometimes there are people both outside of the church and sometimes there are people inside of the church. When something's going on and God has opened up a door of ministry, there are going to be people who will sometimes be a discouragement. They'll press against. They won't help. Don't let that be a deterrent to you to serve. Don't let that stop you. God opens the door. God provides a ministry opportunity. God gives the chance to reach out and see services take place. Let me tell you something. You put your neck to it and get at it. Now, real quickly, I'm going to take about 4 minutes. And I want to just tell you 4 things real quickly about work. And then I'll summarize and our time is done. In fact, let me do this. Let me use the word work, W-O-R-K, as an acrostic. And I'll just give you 4 things about the work of Nehemiah chapter 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Sometime when you have time, you can read through it. But it's all summarized in all the work that needed to happen. Okay. W. If the work is going to be successful, then W, watch out for weariness. Watch out for weariness. The Bible says, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you'll reap if you faint not. We're told to continue the course, to stay the course. I press toward the mark. Don't be weary in what you do. Well, how do you work and not get weary? Well, the way to work and not get weary is when you work together. Did your mom ever use the old adage, many hands make light work? Okay, well, that is true, and it's biblical. If everybody gets on the rope and pulls together, if everybody comes together and works, man, everything gets lighter. The work can be done. So watch out for weariness by working together. Oh, overlook the faults of others. Overlook the faults of others. Now, when I say faults, I'm not talking about sins. If someone sins a sin, then in the body of Christ, in this church, it's right and it's proper, it's appropriate for you to go in Christian love and help get them back. If you see something, you're supposed to go and help them. Not in a mean-spirited way. Some people are like, I'm looking, not like that. But when something is seen, when something's going on, then it's all right to go and talk to somebody. It's right for you to. But when I say the faults of others, I mean the personality differences. How many of you know that you have strengths? That is, things you're good at. Can I see your hand if you know you have strengths? All right. How many of you know you have weaknesses? All right. How many of you know the person beside you has weaknesses? Oh, yeah, I know. That one's so easy to raise your hand to. All right. All of us do. Personality differences. Sometimes personality differences can become a deterrent to work being done because certain personalities, personality differences, hear me, are not a legitimate reason to leave off the work. Everybody's got personality differences. How many of you, anybody here an organized person? Like, you are organized? You just are. It's the way you're built. Your sock drawer has colors and the closet looks, all right. So I always feel badly for anybody that I work with that's organized. Because I'm not what you'd call organized. Not even close. I'm a totally fly by the seat of your pants kind of person. And I think to myself, why would you want to be organized? Because if you get organized, you're just going to have to change anyway. So why not just, hey, you know, have at it. Whatever case, hurrah, hurrah. And we just work and whatever comes around, that's what we're ready for. Okay. All right. So sometimes people who aren't organized, they have to work together. It's like, oh, I feel sorry for one or the other. All right. Sometimes you have to overlook the weaknesses or the strengths, the differences that are between people. And that's normal. Some people are outgoing, and they think everybody ought to be. If you don't smile, there's something wrong with you. Some people, their mouth doesn't turn up. They're just more laid back. They're relaxed. They're more in the background. Okay, look. That's okay. You work together. And sometimes all of us are called to do things, called on to do things that are perhaps out of our comfort zone, and that's okay too. But you have to overlook, you have to recognize the fact that there are strengths, there are weaknesses, and if the work is worthy and it's going to get done, I have to overlook the faults of others. So W, watch out for weariness. O, overlook the faults of others. Quick, R, remember the reason. Remember the reason. The reason for which the wall was built was for the purpose that takes place in Nehemiah chapter 8. Nehemiah 8, the service that takes place in God's word being given, was the whole reason the people needed to get back to God. In order to get back to God, there needed to be a wall built that gave them an identity, that gave them a place to meet. And in order for the wall to be built, Nehemiah had to go and do it. And there had to be work that was put in order for that wall to be built. And remembering the reason. Don't ever forget the reason for which this church exists. If it ceases to reach Fort Lauderdale, then there's a problem. That's the reason why this church exists. If it ceases to help people draw closer to the Lord, then it's lost its purpose. It's lost its reason. If it ever becomes just about itself, if this church becomes inward focused, then friends, there's a problem. It can't get that way. Remember the reason for which the work is being done. So W, watch out for weariness. O, overlook the faults of others. R, remember the reasons. And K, never quit. Never. K-N-E-V-E-R. Quit. K-W-I-T. If it works for knife, it works for never. Never quit. That is. Hey, look. You're going to face times of personal discouragement. You're going to face some of this. You're going to face times when it'd be easy just to... I just want to go and sit and listen and that's it. And be done. It's all I want to do. Yeah, you're going to feel that. You're going to face opportunities when it would be easier for you to take some other path. But remembering the reason, overlooking the faults of others, watching out for weariness, don't quit. Don't quit. Nehemiah 8, listen to me. If Fort Lauderdale is going to be reached, Nehemiah 8 has to take place. There has to be services where God's Spirit moves. There has to be a place. There has to be opportunities for lost people to come in and hear the truth of the gospel. There has to be a place where those who are away from God can come and hear the Word of God and have their hearts challenged and changed. There has to be a place where the Bible can be preached. So don't quit. Don't walk away. Don't, for the sake of personality, take a leave of absence. Oh, there's time for rest. There's time to come apart. I'm not saying don't ever take a vacation. I'm saying you don't quit. You rest. You recharge. You revive. But you don't quit. But you don't quit. Rest if you must. But don't quit. I would love it if for the next 3 nights we had Nehemiah 8 services, where the Spirit and power of God was evident. But Nehemiah 8 services are only possible if you go through Nehemiah chapter 1, 2 through 7, and the Word of God is preached. God's Word must be preached. Time must be spent in prayer. And then thirdly, you've got to do the work. W-O-R-K, work. And Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I ask you please to drive this truth into our hearts and our minds. May we, dear Father, please, by your grace, in seeing the historical account that you gave to us here about what you did through Nehemiah, not that you called us to replicate by building a wall, only that you've written this and you've given it to us so that we can learn an important lesson. And I believe, Father, according to your word, that lesson tonight is the importance of the preaching of your word, how much we need to recognize that we need you and come to you asking you for something you already want to give, but for whatever reason, in your sovereign way, you've asked us to come to you, and in response to our coming to you, you answer. And then, Father, help us to be involved in the work. When you open up doors, help us to go through the doors and continue to work even when there's opposition. Outside the church or inside the church, help us to continue to press on in the work that you've called us to, by your grace, for the sake of what you've called us to do. Now, with heads bowed and eyes closed, let me just real quickly ask several questions. The first one is this. I wonder how many tonight would say, Brother Tim, I see tonight the value, the importance of a Bible preaching ministry. And I see tonight that it needs to be a decision that I make, that wherever God may lead me in the future, wherever He has me in the future, geographically, wherever He puts me, that I need to be invested in and involved in a Bible preaching ministry, a Bible preaching church where God's Word is what is given. And you'd say tonight by an upraised hand, I see the importance and I'm making a decision, God being my help, that I will always be a part of a Bible preaching church where God's Word is what is preeminent. And say, that's something I needed to decide, and tonight I see it, and I'm making a decision regarding that. Is there something like that tonight that I can pray for? God bless you. A number of hands. Wonderful. Wonderful. Oh, I hope that's the dedication and determination of your heart. Secondly, how many tonight would say, really, I this is what I'd love if God would place on the hearts of many of you tonight. How many tonight would say, Brother Tim, I see the importance of Nehemiah chapter 1, that we need to come to God and ask God to do what only He can do if we're going to have Nehemiah 8 services. And I wonder how many tonight would say, Brother Tim, God's dealt in my heart and I see its value, and tonight I am making a commitment to God that if He will help me, I'm going to spend some special time with Him in prayer regarding this ministry, this church, regarding the opportunities to see Him work through this ministry in the area of Fort Lauderdale and surrounding areas. And you'd say tonight, God's dealt in my heart about the importance of talking to Him and spending time in prayer regarding this. And you'd say, my hand is a hand of commitment that I'm going to be about the business of asking God to do what only He can do. And you'd say, as a commitment to God, here's my hand, Brother Tim. I'm going to be a person that prays regarding the outreach and the ministry. Wonderful. Would you mind raising them real high? Just keeping up just for a second. Let me just look. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay. I see 13 hands. And some people may already be involved in it. Great. You can put your hands down. I'm telling you, if 13 people would spend some significant time with God in prayer regarding the desperate need that we have to reach out with the gospel and have these Nehemiah 8 services, I'm telling you, it's a prayer God wants to answer. As you commit to that, listen to me, it's important that you set aside time. When are you going to do it? When are you going to do it? It doesn't have to be, we're not talking about how long you do it, but maybe even setting aside some things that you would normally be involved in for the purpose of asking God. And then lastly, I wonder how many tonight would say, Brother Tim, I need to be involved in the work. I haven't been. Now, a number of you are, and I know that. I saw that on Saturday. I saw that yesterday, as a number of you were invested in and involved in. But if God is dealing your heart about your investment in helping in what's going on here and doing the work, making phone calls, baking some goods for people who are visitors, or making visits, or whatever it takes to be involved and invested in the work that's going on here. I wonder if God's dealt in someone's heart saying, you know what, Brother Tim, I'm really not involved in the work of what's going on here, but I see that it's important and I want to be invested in it and I need to be. Here's my hand. Are there some like that who would say, that's what I need, I haven't been, but I want to be and I'm going to be if God will help me? Okay. And again, I see 5 hands. God bless you. God bless you. Get involved and come see Pastor. Let him help you with it. He'll get you hooked up with some opportunities. I know he will. Everybody, would you look this way? Hey, thanks for your kind attention tonight. I'm going to pray. When I'm finished praying, I'm going to invite us just to take a moment and talk to the Lord regarding what He's dealt with us about. Here's the reason why. This is important. If God dealt in your heart about spending time in prayer, in a minute, when I'm finished praying, I'm going to invite you to either turn and kneel where you are if you're physically able to, or just to have a seat, because we'll be standing in a moment, to have a seat and talk to the Lord so that you can determine when you're going to spend time with the Lord about it. Because if you don't determine when, if you don't set up a plan, then all things being equal, it's not going to happen. You'll walk out of here, something will happen, boom, it's gone. So you determine when it is. Set it up. Set it up in your heart with the Lord. If it's a matter of being invested by being a part of the work, then in that time that I'm going to give you in a moment, you tell the Lord, commit to the Lord. Lord, I'm going to go see Pastor. I'm going to talk to Pastor and ask him about how I can be involved. And then follow through on it. So it gives you an opportunity to solidify that which God has dealt in your heart about. You already raised your hand about it, but you know this. Raising your hand doesn't change anything. But we take steps in that direction. So this, what we call an invitation, is a time where I invite you to tell the Lord that which you've already dealt with, and then make a determination to take that next step. Does that make sense? Okay, let's talk to the Lord about it. If you're able to, would you stand with me? As you stand, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Father, thank you for speaking to our hearts. Help us now, Lord, as we come to you. I should say, Father, rather, help each of us as we come to you to be able to solidify those changes that need to be made so that we can effectively do what you called us to do, so that we can have these Nehemiah 8 services. We want to, for your glory, not for our own, but we want to. And so please hear the prayers of your children as they come before you now. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I ask. Now just quietly, if God dealt in your heart, you're physically able, may I invite you to turn and kneel at your seat, or perhaps just to sit down if that's what needs to happen, and deal with the Lord as he's dealt with you. And then when you're finished, you can stand back to your feet. And when people are finished, when everyone stood back to their feet, then the pastor will come and close the service as he sees fit. But you talk to the Lord about it right now, won't you?